And fade to black, that's the end of Act One. Igor, give me the tech manual.
Give me
an ashtray, will you?
Yeah.
Oh, give me the stapler, Igor. Igor, patch me in a chroma key. Camera four. And put it through the phaser. Oh, and hold all my calls. Igor, I said get me the script for the Steve Martin special. Do it now. Igor, I said get me the script for the Steve Martin special now. Do it now. Go on. This is what he wants to do? Okay.
Out in the West Texas town of El Paso, I fell in love with a Mexican girl. Nighttime would find me in Rose's Cantina. Music would play and Felina would whirl. Blacker than night were the eyes of Felina, wicked and evil while casting a spell. My love was deep for this Mexican maiden. I was in love, but in vain I could tell. One night a wild young cowboy came in, wild as the West Texas wind. Dashing and daring, a drink he was sharing with wicked Felina, the girl that I love. So in anger I challenged his right for the love of this maiden. Down went his hand for the gun that he wore. My challenge was answered in less than a heartbeat. A handsome young stranger lay down on the floor. Just for a moment I stood there in silence, shocked by the foul evil deed I had done. Many thoughts raced through my mind as I stood there. I had but one chance, and that was to run. Out through the back door of Roses I ran, out where the horses were tied. I caught a good one, it looked like it could run, up on its back and away I did ride. Just as fast as I could from the West Texas town of El Paso, out to the badlands of New Mexico. Back in El Paso, my life would be worthless. Everything's gone in life, nothing is left. It's been so long since I've seen the young maid. My love is stronger than my fear of death. I saddled up and away I did go, riding alone in the dark. Worse than this pain in my heart. And at last here I am on the hill overlooking El Paso. I can see Rose's Cantina below. strong and it pushes me onward. Down off the hill to Felina I go. Off to my right I see five mounted cowboys. Off to my left, right, a dozen or more. Shouting and shooting, I can't let them catch me. I have to make it to Rose's back door. Something is dreadfully wrong, for I feel a deep burning pain in my soul. Though I am trying to stay in the saddle, I'm getting weary, unable to ride. But my love strong and I rise where I fall. Though I am weary, I can't stop to rest. I see the white puff of smoke from the rifle. I feel the bullet go deep in my chest. From out of nowhere, Felina has found me, kissing my cheek as she kneels by my side. Cradled by two loving arms that I'll die for. One little kiss and Felina goodbye.
Unto me, and they lay their burden before me, saying, can you take this burden and cleanse it? And I say, yea, I can cleanse this. I can cleanse pants. I can cleanse most any kind of fabric, even though the devil hath cast a pizza upon them. They come to me with shirts that have had buttons torn from them in passion or anger. And they say, can you make it as though new? And I say, yea, but it shall take another day.
So when will these be ready?
Let me read you from this text, the yellow pages, page 4327, where it says 4-day service. 4-day service. Say it with me.
4-day service.
4-day service. And we shall live according to the promises made in this book. Now, do you believe that I shall have your clothes cleansed in 4 days?
I believe.
Do you believe that I shall repair the button upon thy shirt?
Oh, yes, I do.
Do you believe that I have been given the power to validate your parking ticket? Well, let me take the symbol of your enslavement and place this stamp upon it. And when ye present this to the guardian of the gate, he shall raise the bar. And ye shall be free to pass unto the city whereupon you dwell. But I say unto you, once ye have departed the gate, do not turn back.
Not turn back.
Lest ye suffer severe tire damage.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, oh great dry cleaner, thank you.
Go out unto the mall and spread the good news of my dry cleaning service.
I will tell everyone. I tell everyone of the dry cleaner.
O'Dale, take these raiments and cast them upon the waters of the Maytag.
Really, Steve, I wish you'd let us get you a cab.
Hey, I'm okay. Don't worry about me.
Come on, buddy. Well, why don't you sleep over? We got a sleeper sofa down in the rumpus room.
Hey, get out of here. Come on. I'm fine. It was a great party. Gadzook. I mean, let a guy be responsible.
You really ought to stop him.
Don't worry. He'll be all right.
How many times has this happened? You invite someone to a party. He has too much to drink. And then he gets behind the wheel of a steamroller. Statistics show that nearly half of all steamroller accidents involve drunk drivers. But statistics don't mean a whole lot when this happens. Next time, keep the keys to his steamroller. He'll flat out thank you in the morning.
Hi, I'm Arthur Fleischman, and I beat inflation. Call me lucky, call me smart, but I'm standing in front of a house for which I recently paid only $16,000.
Hi, Arthur.
Hi, honey. My neighbor paid over $80,000 for his house. And just recently, my other neighbor paid over $110,000 for his. Just goes to show you, with the right offer at the right time, there are still bargains to be found. See, I believe the average citizen can beat inflation. Prices go up because we let them go up. It's just a matter of telling your realtor what you think the house is worth, and then sticking to it. You know, you'd be surprised how many people would take your offer just to get out from under their own financial burdens. Just because somebody asks a big price don't mean you have to pay it.
Help! Help!
Oh, sure. There's some dang things need to be done to this place. That step on the back porch needs to be fixed, and we're getting estimates to stop the walls from bleeding. And Martha would like a bigger laundry room and a house where cats don't talk. It's kind of weird to be sitting at dinner and watch Grandma melt and see the kids turn into bats. You say, what the hell was that? Well, anyway, I've done something about inflation. How about you?
There are two in.
I know. You want to be like me. A love god. When the women see me, they always wonder, who is this mysterious stranger? Is he a rich, handsome prince? Or is he just a fancy pants? Well, now for today's lesson. One of the most important things in impressing a woman is knowing how to order in a restaurant. Oh, waiter, we are ready. First, the wine.
White or red?
What? You have colors? Oh, boy! Do you have beige? I'll tell you what. Just bring us the best beige wine in the house. Or maybe a nice tweed. Now for the food. What animals do you have steaks of?
Cows.
What? You would eat a cow? Bossy with the big sad eyes? Those cute little creatures? What else?
Lamb?
What? Those cute little fuzzy guys? Baba black sheep? Forget you, boy. Tell you what, bring me a pig on a stick.
And fry him up good. And bring the lady something for $1.50. Now, to get the woman in a love-making mood. How about those Yankees, huh? I love it when they bunt. Well, rat season is almost here. By now, she is in the mood to do anything. I suppose you know where this evening is going to end. With your heart racing and your blood pulsing with excitement.
Well, Be gentle with me. It's my first time.
What? I was hoping one of us had a little experience. Well, they come to me, a little girl. But they leave a man. By now, she had had an evening she will never forget. Anything that happens from now on will be a bonus for her. Well, I hope you'll learn something. Food and love go together as naturally as teenagers and drugs. Good luck from the love god, you crazy guy.
There's a light mist in the air. Do you think that'll have any effect on any of the divers?
Well, it's probably going to change the water level. And this is a game of inches. You can't, right. You know.
Well, it will have an effect on those people who like to be wet before they go into the water. It gives them an advantage.
I think so. It eliminates the shock of hitting the water.
There's old Pills up there now.
Oh, yes. Next up is Pills Olofsson of Sweden. He'll have to nail a good one here, Carl, to maintain third place.
Exactly, Dick. Pills has been off his form today. But the double gainer with a half twist is one of his best dives. Let's see if he can hit it.
That'll cost him.
He tried to force it and he came up short. Tough break.
There are the scores. Not too good. He'll drop back to fourth.
The young Swede is not too happy with himself. And here's your leader, Steve Martin of the United States. He has completely dominated this event.
He could play it safe with this dive, but that's not Martin's style. He's going for a cannonball off the edge of the pool. Or the degree of difficulty is unbelievable. I've ever seen a prettier cannonball, Carl. The big splash, the loud ka-thunk sound, it was all there.
That is one of the best and loudest ka-thunks I've ever heard.
His ka-thunk is virtually unique.
Martin is way out in front with those scores. He's doing much better in this event than he did in the swimming competition.
Exactly, Carl. He's doing much better in this event. But let's flash back to yesterday when young Martin had his troubles in the 400-meter freestyle.
Oh, that he did. Now, Martin is not one to make excuses, but he did mention after the race that he was given the slowest lane. He said that the other swimmers had these slick lanes, and he was given one with very dense water in it, making it very difficult to swim. There was some kind of frictionalized particles in it, he said, that was adhering to his skin and sort of acting as water breaks.
We're back live now with Steve Martin preparing for his final dive. Concentration is written all over that young man's face.
That young man breaks all the rules. I have never seen anyone eating a tuna sandwich before a major dive.
Exactly, Carl. That man is unique. Now let's look at some of his earlier dives.
We're on tape now. First, the pretending to get shot off the board dive. Next, the screaming like a maniac dive. The judges love his originality. Let's look at that one again. Notice his wild flailing of the arms and how the feet are constantly in motion. And look at the perfect entry in the water with his face full of grimace. And here is the beautifully classic straight in. The mandatory accidental tripping dive. And here's the suspended in mid-air dive. Notice the position of the arms, exactly parallel to the water. And again, the perfect entry. But this is the big one. He'll attempt to catch a beach ball in mid-air. He's putting his sandwich away for later. Approaches the end of the board. Crowd is very silent. He's getting ready. He nods for the toss. Here it comes. Oh, it's too high. A bad throw. He missed. Oh, this is going to hurt him badly. Look at those scores. Oh, Mr. Martin's going to have to settle for second place.
Wait a minute. Martin is pretending like he's drowned. What a great idea. Yes, this has convinced the judges to raise the scores.
And now the Romanian team is jumping in the water. They're all pretending to be drowned. But it's too late. Martin gets the goal.
Martin gets the goal. The Romanian team tried to steal his thunder by jumping in the water, but Mr. Martin did it first, did it better, and won the whole event. He might be drowned, ladies. No, he's pretending, but he pretends so well, there's no telling. He's got a little froth at the mouth. His face is a little blue, but he's not drowned, ladies and gentlemen. He's just pretending.
The Romanians are not pretending.
If mascara could satisfy your rational...
One of the most popular shows on television. We're led to believe that it's an honest and forthright example of investigative journalism. But several days ago, I received a letter that made me doubt the integrity of this program. Oh, I receive a lot of crank mail, and I usually just toss it in the wastebasket. But this letter had an unmistakable air of authenticity and intelligence about it, and it made some very challenging accusations. Mike Wallace is a stinker. This letter raises several important issues. First, why is it called 60 Minutes when it's really only 58 minutes and 20 seconds? And why did 60 Minutes, initially a low-rated news program, suddenly burst into the top 10? Did they buy off the Nielsen rating service? Were certain cash payments made to executives of that company? And what about Morley Safer, a Canadian? That's right, a Canadian. Why is a Canadian doing a job that an American could do just as well? And if we were to go to war with Canada, whose side would he fight on? The Americans or them? Here's what happened earlier at the CBS building when we tried to get some answers to these questions. I'm Steve Martin. I'd like to get an interview with Mike Wallace.
Oh, I'm sorry. Mr. Wallace is in Washington.
Then your answer is no?
Well, he's in Washington, like I said.
You've heard it for yourself. Mike Wallace has refused to talk to me. Insulated. Mike Wallace has luncheon here just about every day, doesn't he?
Yeah.
What does he usually have?
Well, it varies. Tuna salad, corned beef hash, ham and cheese.
Then you'd say he has a regular American's lunch, a patriot's lunch.
Yeah.
Where do you get your tuna fish?
Out of a can.
A can like this? Packed in Japan? And isn't it true your cheese is Swiss and your corned beef comes from Argentina?
Yeah.
So, every day, Mike Wallace comes in here and has an exotic foreign lunch.
No, sometimes we deliver it.
By courier?
Yeah.
Let me sum this up. Every day, Mike Wallace has a secret courier deliver an exotic foreign lunch. I am standing with Mr. Ernest Lubwitz, who is a close personal friend of a guy who knows someone who met Mike Wallace's brother. Is that true, Mr. Lubwitz?
Well, actually, I met the wife of a close personal friend of someone who met Mike Wallace's brother.
Well, I think that pretty much makes you an authority on Mike Wallace. Now, Mr. Lubwitz, is it true that Mike Wallace had liquor on his breath on New Year's Eve of 1969?
Well, like I say, I only know a friend of a guy who...
Were you with this friend on that particular New Year's Eve?
I can't remember that far back.
Well, you'd say that the odds were 50-50 that you were.
The odds wouldn't be that high, actually.
Well, you were either with him or you weren't, right?
Huh?
Well, that, my friend, is 50-50. Now, did your friend mention anything about Mike Wallace having liquor on his breath?
Definitely not.
Well, there you have it, ladies and gentlemen. Proof that someone may or may not be trying to conceal the fact that Mike Wallace may or may not have had liquor on his breath on New Year's Eve of 1969. And that comes from a guy who met the wife of a close personal friend who knows someone who met Mike Wallace's brother. I think that polishes off 60 Minutes. Be sure to join me on my next special when I ask the question, Tom Snyder, is he real or is he wax? Good night. Socrates, the trial is over. Here's your hemlock.
Ah, thank you.
Well, what was the verdict? When do I get out of here?
But Socrates, the verdict was death.
Death? You gotta be kidding me. For what?
For teaching the youth wisdom.
Well, I'll take it all back. Call him in here. I'll renounce everything. Let's get out of here. Let's go get some Chinese food.
But Socrates, you drank the hemlock.
So what?
It's poisonous.
It is? Since when?
Didn't you know hemlock is poisonous?
I do now. Look, I only know general things. What is truth? What is justice? I never learned details. I don't know what is poisonous and what is not poisonous. This is the kind of thing that irritates me about you guys. Oh. All right. So, I'm going to die. So what? When's this stuff take effect? 2-3 years?
2-3 minutes.
What a lousy day this was. All right. I'm gonna lay here, and I'm going to die. And you know what's going to happen? You guys are gonna go out, and you'll have dinner, and you'll sit and stare at each other. I was the only one who ever talked in this whole group. It was always Socrates, what is truth? Socrates, what is the nature of the good? Socrates, what should I order? Socrates, what are you having? And not once did anyone ever say, Socrates, hemlock is poison.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, Plato. How do you do that?
What?
Make your body like rubber. You know, I could eat 1,000 chocolate chip cookies right now.
I'm okay. I feel better.
Must have been just a passing from...
Yes, Master.
What did he say?
He said, "Come, Mr. Tallyman, tally me banana. Daylight come, and me wanna go home."
Suddenly, your long distance...
...this morning, and I lost everything I own. Thank goodness I'm insured by Mutual of Steve.
Hi, Mr. Wilson.
Hi. Gee, I wish you could have got here sooner, Steve. I called you 5 hours ago.
Hey, I was cleaning my pool, okay? Boy, you people with insurance claims think you're the only people in the world. Well, what's the problem?
My house burned down.
What? You call this burned? This is nothing. You brought me all the way up here for this?
What?
Sure, just clean up some of this soot. Put a plastic cover on this, a little paint on this, it'll look as good as new.
Wait a minute, you mean to tell me you're not gonna give me anything? Not a cent?
Hey, wait a minute. I don't like your attitude. I have people with real problems, okay? Look, you've got a homeowner's policy, right?
Yeah.
I don't see a home. When you get a home, you give me a call, and I'll sell you another policy.
Thank you.
Mutual of Steve. For the really, really major disasters in your life, don't bother us with the small stuff.
The following is a public service announcement.
Can I help you, boys?
Yeah, I'll take a mint.
Mint?
Couple of ski masks.
Two ski masks.
Keychain.
Keychain.
And some plutonium, please.
Okay, plutonium's over on aisle 3. Say, you boys have a note from the government for that plutonium?
Gee, I must have forgot it.
Sorry, gotta have a note from the government.
Well, okay, then we'll just take gum and lifesavers.
Okay, they're over on aisle 3, right next to the plutonium.
Come on, come on.
Remember, plutonium is the main ingredient in an atom bomb. Keep it down behind the counter, away from terrorists. Be wise and beware. Right, Hootie, the radioactive owl?
Now it's time for Bizarre Oddities of the World.
The world is filled with many strange and wonderful things.
Come with me as we leave behind the civilized workaday world of 9 to 5 and we enter the bizarre world of 8:30 to 4:15. And who knows, if our courage holds up, we may even visit the frightening and fantastic world of 6:45 to 9:11. And we'll visit a tribe in New Guinea who actually believe the universe was formed by an ancient explosion called the Big Bang. And we'll visit a psychic in California who actually believes there is a land north of the United States called Canada. So if you're ready, let's go. Going to visit the land that time forgot. A small island in the Atlantic that somehow got stuck in time. History and the changes of man have passed it by, and the creatures who live here are from an age long gone. Let's take a look. Hi.
Peace.
Those are really nice love beads.
Wow, a stranger. Hey, you want to join our love in?
Sure.
You really freaked me out. I thought you might be a narc. It really blew my mind.
Yeah, that's really heavy.
What sign are you? You're a Pisces, right?
That's right. You must have picked up on my vibes.
Wow, this guy's really on a bummer. Come on, Sunflower. Let's go crash with a stash and fool around.
Oh, I know. I shouldn't laugh. But thank God today we are not slaves to fashion, and we found things that have true lasting value. Things like roller disco, plastic see-through pants, and timeless expressions like go for it. They're going to be around a long time. The West has its fabled Bigfoot, but here in the East, high in the Himalayas, they have the legend of the abdominal snowman. Abdominable. Abdominable? Abominable. 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 The abdominable, abominable, 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 abominable. I'm standing in the tiny Mideast country of say what. Unlike other countries in this region, this one has no oil reserves. Despite that, they are the richest nation on earth. They have achieved their great wealth through begging. That's right. The entire country begs for a living. This man is the king of say what. Why is he king? Because he is the best beggar in all the land.
My wife's veils are in shreds. My car has no diesel, sir. We have no oil. Our treasury is completely depleted. Please. Oh, thank you, sir.
Is he beautiful? Is he great? Now, to demonstrate, we've asked His Majesty to beg from this poor beggar over here, one of the poorest beggars in all the land. This
oh,
man
please,
has nothing.
Sir,
let's listen.
Please contribute to our country. We are desperately poor. Please, sir, our treasury is bankrupt. My wives need clothes. I have no oil for my car. Please, sir, anything you can afford. We'll be so, so grateful. Please, sir. Oh, Oh, thank you.
Look at that. He has begged a lint ball from a man who has nothing. A lint ball, ladies and gentlemen. What a splendid performance. And he's going for more. Can you believe this? More from nothing.
If you're coming to Portugal this year, be sure to have your cavities filled before you get here. Why? Because here in Portugal, they still rely on the primitive method of trampoline dentistry.
Pardon me. Can you tell me where the Great Pyramids of Egypt are? Thank you. Thank you, too. At last, after 5,000 miles, the Great Pyramids of Egypt! You work here?
Yes, I work here.
Are these the Great Pyramids of Egypt?
Yes, many millennia ago, hundreds and thousands of slaves toiled and died in the building of these monuments to the memory of the great pharaohs, yes.
But they're only 3 feet tall. They look so big in the photograph.
We have little figures. We put them next to the pyramids, and we take shots of them, pictures, photographs, from up and down the side and all over, okay?
Are the pharaohs buried in there?
Only the heads.
I don't know. It seems like a gyp.
Closing time. Come on.
Closing?
Closing. It's all over. It's finished. I go home to my wife. I'm going to watch television. I don't need you. Goodbye. Good luck. And take we'll finish someplace else. All right? Goodbye.
Oil? Oil!
Hooray!
Wait, it's not oil. It's maple syrup.
Hooray!
The Queen Mary, the eighth wonder of the world. The real question is, how could something that weighs 81,000 tons rule a country? This is truly one of the bizarre oddities of the world. Abominable, the abominable, abominable. Abominable, abominable, abominable. Visiting a tribe of people 1,000 miles off the coast of New Guinea, whose existence up till now was only an unsubstantiated rumor. Who are they? The hairdressers of Borneo. These people believe that if they give good hairstylings, someday celebrities from America will come and pay them up to $45 for a hairstyling and $10 extra for a razor cut. No manicure, just a haircut and a shrinking. For the past few minutes, the wonder of the earth has been ours. Some of you may have been shocked by what you have just seen, but who are we to sit on our high horse and judge these things? Can we really look down upon our fellow man and call him barbaric? Yes, we can.
This has been Bizarre Oddities of the World.
I'm ready for the last number.
Steve, I just discovered that somebody switched the scripts. We've been shooting the wrong one. This is the right script.
I knew there was something wrong. That stuff we've been shooting is not me. Now this is me. Let's take it from the top.
Okay, from the top, everybody.
Later tonight, Cagney and Lacey search for a missing husband and uncover a motive for murder. But first, a rapist runs free while his victim is charged with a crime on Jake and the Fat Man, next.